blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glory. Closes in, Lord, still I'm gonna say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Yeah, yeah. You kill and take away. Oh, you kill and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Brett, I just want you to know the Colts are going to lose today. So enjoy that hoodie. Props to him for wearing it, despite their imminent defeat at the hands of my 1-3-1 Bengals. Anyway, thank you this morning. And I am excited to start a new series. We spent 9 months and some time and change in the book of Leviticus, which I think has been great. And I hope that after that, you walked away thinking it wasn't as boring as you thought it was last January. So this next 4 weeks, we are going to start a new series here. And I want to just kind of introduce that with my hopes and the direction that I kind of put out and that the elders helped steer with me as well. And so to do that, I've got a lot of qualifiers here to start because of the culture that we live in, right? So we are going to look at over the next 4 weeks what it looks like to have a biblical worldview of politics. So having said that, I think the only thing that upsets people more than religion is politics. So that's part of the reason we're looking at that. And as well, I want to start out with a couple of disclaimers. So to start, here's what we will not be doing over the next 4 weeks. Number one, I'm not going to be partisan. Meaning, I'm not going to, if you think you hear me advocating for one side or the other indefinitely, then you've misheard me and I've misspoken. I'm not advocating for one or the other. In fact, it is illegal for me to advocate for one or the other due to our tax-exempt status. So I will not be doing that. The other thing is I will also not be endorsing any candidate. And the reason for that is I don't like either of them, number one. Number two, I'd probably just upset half of you with that. And again, I'm not allowed to do that. So thank you for that law. And then as well, what I'm not trying to do is I'm not trying to get you to vote a certain way. I want you to think through biblically how we vote or if we vote, those kind of questions, right? I want you to vote based upon your conscience through a biblical worldview, how you settle that. And then as well, I am not going to be pushing any form of government. So I'm not pushing any type of mindset like capitalism or socialism or somewhere in between or conservative or liberal or any of those things. So here's what I want us to do. I want you to think of what you think is the evil form of government. So maybe you hate socialism or you hate capitalism, right? So now I want you to repeat after me. Paul is not speaking for or against. And now insert whatever you thought of. Yes, thank you. All right. And the same thing goes with what we are for, right? I'm not pushing in that direction. That is not what we're doing. What we are going to look at is what Scripture says. And we are going to try to walk away from this in 4 weeks, realizing what Scripture says about these things. And I also want to throw out a caveat that I don't take for granted, maybe I do take for granted, the ability to stand up here this morning and share Scripture with you and share the gospel. So I fully recognize that I am fortunate and blessed, that I'm not worried about them going and taking my kids away from me because I said this, because this is happening all over the world. So we appreciate the fact that people did a lot of work to found this place. We have people who have served in our armed forces to help protect those things. And so we want to thank people like that. And this is not an anti-American tirade over the next 4 weeks. That's not what it is. It is a what does Scripture say and how can we be good citizens of our country, okay? So I appreciate that. I love that. If anything sounds a little too harsh, please see my heart in that. And know that we are passionate about Scripture and about the gospel. And then as well, if I make you upset over the next 4 weeks, there you go, Sandra, too bad. My goal is not to stir you up, but my goal is for the Holy Spirit to convict us all of our short-sightedness and our short thinking, right? So while putting this together, I was convicted about something. I took a screenshot and said, Whitney, and said, ouch. So I've been convicted through this process as well, and I hope that we all grow together. If I do step on your toes, please feel free to let me know. You can come by the office, email me, and I'd love to talk through that because either that means the Holy Spirit is convicting you or I misspoke and upset you, and I'd love to talk about that versus just being upset. And so what we want to see here is we want really to see how much of an idol we've created out of this, especially here in the States. And all of these principles, will be universal. So we've got, I don't know if you realize, we have friends in Nigeria and Rwanda and a couple other countries watching our live streams here. So to the world, these are applicable principles for all people everywhere. And so I have a quote here from Tim Keller I wanted to read. It says, when thinking about this, one of the signs that an object is functioning as an idol is that fear becomes one of the chief characteristics of our life. When we center our lives on the idol, we become dependent on it. For our counterfeit God is threatened in any way, our response is complete panic. We do not say, oh, what a shame, how difficult, but rather, this is the end, there is no hope. So, hopefully none of you feel that way, but I have heard friends and family and people all around, they, you know, Bush got elected and it was the end of the world, and then President Obama was elected and we were all going to die, and then Donald Trump got elected and it was all going to end. In fact, I thought it was interesting about the candidate that the one of the parties was genuinely concerned was the Antichrist, because he was going to come in with his kind of agnostic deist views and do away with some of the things that they had done, and that was Thomas Jefferson. So we go all the way back to even the third president and see that people are scared when they make the government their idol. And we've all seen the pictures of people crying and screaming and all these different things. That is what hopelessness looks like when we think that the government is going to save us. So here's a roadmap over the next 4 weeks. And my other disclaimer with that is today is an incomplete thought. I'd like to wrap this section up, this passage, for us this morning, but this is a four-week series, so I'd like to say everything this morning, but, you know, time. So 4 weeks, and we have to realize that there's some, you know, some thumbnails we're going to put and tack that up for a minute and then get back to it next week or the week after. And so we have this roadmap in our mind. What we're going to look at over the next 4 weeks is we're going to see today that the kingdom of heaven transcends. All right, we're going to see how it transcends. Next week, we're going to answer the question, what is the Christian position? That's kind of a bait and switch, but we'll get that. So, what's the Christian position? And then as well, the week before the election, we're going to look and see that the war is not across an aisle. So the war isn't on one side or the other, and we're not fighting across the aisle. And then finally, regardless of whatever happens the first week of November, the sermon will be the same. The last week is that the president is not in charge. So, regardless of who wins, the president is not in charge. All right, so handling those nuances and looking at this, let's dive into today's text. So today we are looking at Philippians chapter 3. And the main verse that we are really focusing on here is in verse 20, the Apostle Paul, from prison, being persecuted, writes, "Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly wait for a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ." So in order to understand the buildup for that, let's take a look at what Paul is saying that builds up to this ultimate point of this passage. I kind of want to go through quickly what the buildup is here, and we could spend a few months probably dissecting chapter 3. So we'll skip over some points that are not relevant to what we're examining today, but know that there's a lot packed into this chapter. So starting in verse 1, Paul is writing again from prison. He's writing to the church in Philippi, and he says, all right, he says in chapter 3, referencing everything he's written so far, "In addition, my brothers and sisters, let's rejoice in the Lord. To write to you again about this is no trouble for me and is a safeguard to you." So the good news is that even 2,000 years ago, people forgot what people said right afterwards, right? He's either told them in person or written a letter before, and he's like, hey, I need to remind you. So again, this is a reminder for us as we look at this, and we have to be reminded of focusing on Christ. He says, what he wants to do is, he says in verse 2, "Watch out for the dogs, watch out for the evil workers, and watch out for those who mutilate the flesh." So what Paul is saying is, hey, watch out for the fake news. There is tons of disinformation being spread, and I hear that you guys have been listening to some of that. And he compares the people sharing this fake news about what their hope should be in, he compares it to like a rabid stray dog that bites you when you walk up to pet it on the street. And he compares it to people who are literally working out evil. And as well, he says, the mutilation of the flesh. So without being too graphic, you know, Paul writes a lot about circumcision because that was the sign for the Jewish people in the Old Covenant that they were part of God's people. And now he's saying that they put so much hope in that. The word he uses here is the same word for, if you know the story, the prophets of Baal, and they're trying to get the fire to send down from heaven, and nothing happens. So they start screaming, and they start self-harming and cutting themselves. That's the word Paul uses here for circumcision, that people are self-harming themselves and mutilating themselves to try to be good enough or try to be righteous. And he says this because while circumcision was a good thing, and today it's a fine thing if it's a medical reason, but he's saying they're putting their confidence in this action that they take because it was a sign that we were God's people, but now you have to realize this has been opened up to the entire world to draw people from every nation to serve and worship Christ. And so he in fact says in verse 3, "For we are the circumcision." What he means is it's no longer that cutting, that procedure that shows the world that you are God's. Now, we are the ones that reflect that we belong to God through our daily lives. We are that symbol. We are that circumcision. We're the ones who worship by the Spirit of God. We boast and we have our confidence and we have all those things in Christ Jesus, and we don't put confidence in the flesh. We don't put confidence in the actions that we take. We brag about our Savior who loves us. And he goes on, he's going to talk about his self-righteousness here. So what he says is, although I have every reason for confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he has grounds for confidence in the flesh, I have more. And again, I'm not picking on it, but man, that sounded just like Donald Trump to me, President Trump. Like, he's like, look, if anybody should be proud, it should be me. I'm the best at keeping the Jewish law. And I would be the one that has the right to brag, right? And he says, I have more. I was circumcised on the eighth day of the nation of Israel. I was born of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew, born of Hebrews, regarding the law as a Pharisee, regarding zeal, persecuting the church, regarding the righteousness that is in the law and blameless. So if we could be good enough to earn our way to heaven, which we can't, Paul is saying, look, I've tried all that. I was the best at this. He was a rabbi. He was a teacher. I believe, and a lot of people believe as well, he was a member of the Sanhedrin, which is like kind of the political leadership of Israel. So he is on a career trajectory of being a mega church preacher and also a member of Congress. And he's got this great career path planned out. And he says, you can't blame me. I've been following all the rules. And if anyone has the right to feel like they have earned their self-righteousness, it would be me. And as we look at this, is there anyone more self-righteous than politicians? Maybe pastors, but he says, I would be the one that had the right to brag about this. So what do I, as the person who was blameless, what do I realize about all that self-righteousness of checking off the right boxes, doing good things, being at church, donating to Operation Christmas Child, working at the fair trade sale? How many of those things, what do I think about them now as ways of earning God's favor? He says in verse 7, but everything that was a gain to me, all those things that I thought I was doing correctly because I could make God love me more if I did those things, I thought that was gain. I thought that was my long-term investment on how to do things. But now after coming to Christ, Paul says, I have considered it to be a loss because of Christ. That word loss, and I have to apologize, I realized I did not put the vocab words here so you can study up on the screen. But let me explain to you here. This word that often says that it's a loss, in Greek, it is the word, I would translate it better as a disadvantage. So it's zemian, Z-E-M-I-A-N. Zemian, and it means like you're at a disadvantage because you don't have any money or possessions. You start out at a disadvantage. And he's saying, I thought all these things I was doing, all these things I was pushing and moving forward and trying to take the world by force and earn my forgiveness, earn my salvation, I thought that was everything. And now I realize what I've been taught my whole life is actually a disadvantage to me. I know a lot of you, and I feel this way too, sometimes I have to unlearn these human-made traditions about church, or, you know, we say things and then we realize, wait, that's not actually in the Bible, but someone told me that in Sunday school. Like, We have to unlearn these things sometimes, and we sometimes start out at a disadvantage, thinking that we could perhaps make God love us anymore, that we have to clean ourselves up before we can come to Christ and ask for forgiveness, or any of these mindsets are actually now a disadvantage to us. You're better off without having those disadvantages in you. And then in verse 8, he says, more than that, even more than it being just a disadvantage, I consider everything, all of that, my career, my political standing, my religious standing, all of my friends, all of my family, all these works that I have busted my backside to earn, it's not just a disadvantage. He says, I consider it all to be that disadvantage in the view of pursuing the value of knowing Christ as Lord. And he goes on and says, more in verse 8, he says, because of him, because of Christ, I have suffered the loss of all things. So I'm giving up my political standing. I'm giving up my religious standing. I'm losing my friends. I'm losing family. I'm losing everything I've set forward to. I'm restarting my entire life in middle age. All these things I've lost. And in fact, I now consider them as, now, your Bible passage, Dan's looking at me because I shared with him this week, your Bible passage is going to say dung or waste. The word Paul uses in Greek is actually a little profane. And I think the intention of that too is, one, we can see Paul's passion and how strongly he feels about this, and we can imagine the church in Philippi reading this word and being shocked. I'm going to go with a different four-letter word, and I'm going to use the word crap. I think that's about as far as I can push the envelope this morning. He says all those things are a load of crap. It's all a bunch of BS. All of that stuff is. I'm at a loss here, and I realize how worthless these things are. He says, I consider them that so that I may gain Christ. I have let go of all those things in my former way of thinking, in my former way of life, so that I can cling to the King, the only one that matters, Christ. He says in verse 9, I want to gain Christ that I may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own from the law, so that self-righteousness he thought he had, he's realizing was nothing. But a righteousness that is through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on so because of all those things he thought he was doing right, he realized he had just been shoveling the pile. It was all actually a disadvantage for him. And now all that matters to him is knowing Christ Jesus and realizing we can't do enough to make ourselves right in relationship to God. We can't earn that. He says it is here through his faith in Christ, which is a gift from God, that grace from God to believe and to trust in Christ. So how has he turned his path? What is he looking forward to? He says in verse 10, my goal is to know him, to know Christ in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, assuming that I will somehow reach the resurrection from the dead. So he's saying here, his goal now is to live for Christ. He's writing from prison, being persecuted for his faith, that I want to suffer in the same way that Christ has suffered, to experience that, to live a life where I give up all of the pleasures that are set aside here, all the self-righteousness to live for, to suffer alongside with, and to look forward to Christ's return and resurrection. Now, as a side note, I don't like here how it says assuming in verse 11. So I just wanted to point out here, because when you read that, it says assuming, it makes it sound like Paul perhaps doesn't have a lot of confidence in the gospel. He says assuming, hopefully, and it's interesting in the Greek here, it's just one little word. It's E-I. And really, all that means is it's forming the two together. It's a conjunction. It means like if, then, so that. So the more literal reading here would be that I want to be following Christ, conformed to his death, so that I will reach the resurrection from among the dead. I want to trust in Christ and know that when he returns, He will physically resurrect, and all of us who are trusting in him will spend eternity with him in the flesh, living with him. And that is my hope here. So he goes on in verse 12 forward, and he is saying, okay, so we've established that my old way of living, me pushing the political and religious things and doing all the things that are supposed to earn me God's favor are all a pile of garbage. And here is what we should be striving to. He says, look, verse 12, not that I have already reached the goal or I am already perfect, but I make every effort to take hold of it because I also have been taken hold of by Christ. He's saying, Christ knocked me off that horse. He has called me into life in him, and I am following him. And he's saying, I hope what you see here when I'm sharing is, hey, I don't have this figured out. I'm studying scripture and praying, and I'm admitting how imperfect I am, but saying, let's go for this together. Let's walk out this Christian walk together, and we know we're not perfect, and we're trusting in Christ. He says, I don't consider that I've done that. He says, but one thing I do is I am forgetting what is behind, and I'm reaching forward to what is ahead. I pursue as my goal the prize promised by God's heavenly call in Christ Jesus. So Paul is saying, I'm imperfect. I'm entirely laying myself down and resting on Jesus' grace and his righteousness that he has given to me, the fact that he is resurrected from the dead, and I have confidence in this hope that he has given me. And all these things that I used to think were the means of doing good and being a good person and doing the right thing, I'm realizing that while I should still be a responsible neighbor and good citizen and push and help Christ's love be spread to the world, what I do realize is that I got to leave a lot of that in the past. So let's forget that old lifestyle. Maybe for you, it was self-righteousness. Maybe for you, it was the exact opposite. You thought you were the worst person alive. And until coming to Christ, realized that we all are at a disadvantage and short and needing his grace and his mercy. But whatever it was back there that we are so focused on in the past of trying to recreate or trying to salvage or any of those things, we got to put that in the back seat, and we have to keep our eyes focused on the return of Christ. Because when we focus on the return of Christ, it puts everything into perspective. So we no longer have to train our children to make the most money possible or to get the most power or influence as possible to do all these things. We train the next generation to focus on the return of Christ, knowing that when he comes back, if we are followers of his, we will spend eternity with him. And while we don't earn God's love any extra or his forgiveness at all by doing these things, it's like, guys, if your wife gets home and you like did the dishes and put some flowers on the counter, like she loved you regardless, but hey, I appreciate you. It's a little hint for this week, guys. But what I'm saying is we do these things and we stand before Christ and he says, hey, good job. We do these things because he's returning, and it puts everything into perspective. And he says here in verse 15, therefore, let all of us who are mature think this way. And if you think differently about anything, God will reveal it to you also. In any case, we should live up to the whatever truth we have attained. Now, I really appreciate how snarky Paul is in this passage here. So he's been passionate, used a little bit of strong language, and as well now, he is writing to this church in Philippi, and he is contesting against people who are telling that church that you can earn your righteousness. You can be perfect if you just follow the law of the Old Testament to a T. If you just do what I say and you vote the right way and you think the right way, you can be perfect. They're out teaching that it's required that we be perfect in what we do. And so Paul, kind of like a slam dunk to their face, writes, okay, so those of us who are actually perfect because we are resting on Christ's perfection, those of us who are perfect, a lot of versions say mature, but the word, that's like a third or fourth meaning there. It is, he's talking about perfection here, and he's saying we are mature believers and that we are trusting in Christ's perfection, and we're only perfect because Christ took our sheet of sins and nailed it to a cross and transferred over his perfect life into our account. So we are standing in perfection before God as forgiven by Christ. And so this is how we should think. And then he gets away with it, I guess, because he's inspired by the Holy Spirit. He says, if you don't agree with me, God will help you figure this out. So if I said that, I'd probably get in trouble. Anyway, so Paul is saying this is the way we have to think. And if you don't think this way yet, ask God to change your mind, because this is how we ought to think. We ought to live up to the truth that we have understood, and that is the message of Christ as our Savior. So he goes on and says, join on in imitating me, brothers and sisters, and pay careful attention to those who live according to the example you have in us. So he's calling for unity in the church. He's not calling for us to agree with each other. He's not calling for us to all put ourselves into one lump thing, and if we disagree, we just have to let that go and forget it and just think whatever the person in charge thinks. He's saying we need to process these things through Christ, through Scripture, allowing the Holy Spirit to transform our minds so that maybe we disagree on the way of accomplishing a task, maybe we disagree on the priority of a thing, but together we be in sound mind knowing that this is the instructions for how we ought to think. And as well, not just in, you know, we could think he's egotistical and say, hey, follow me by example. He says, also the others, you see mature believers. There are mature believers here that I'm looking at right now. And for younger Christians, don't just look at my example, maybe just as a how not to, but there are people who have been following Christ for almost their entire life. Follow their example. Ask them to help you grow in those things. He's saying there's two groups here. There are Christ's disciples, people who are following Jesus, very imperfect, but repenting and believing in him and trusting him. And then there are people of this world who think that they can be good and do good and be righteous based upon what they are accomplishing or what rules or standards they follow through on. Those are the two groups that we have here. And he says in verse 18, I have told you, and now I'm saying it again with tears. He is writing or orating this letter, and he is crying because he is so passionate about what is taking place here. Should have brought Dan up for this. Could have backed me up, Dan. But he says that many live as enemies of the cross. And what are those enemies sharing? He says there's four things that these enemies of the cross are propagating, whether they realize actively that they are against the cross or they think that this world system that they adhere to is the right way. They say, number one, in verse 19, their end is destruction. If they are against the cross, they're not building something new. They're not building a great society. They're not building a righteous life. They are headed to eternal damnation because their end is destruction. And then two and three go together. He says, their God is their stomach and their glory is their shame. Now, when I was younger, I used to be a little concerned because I thought maybe he was like, they really like to eat. There's some fatties and they just worship the fact that they can have whatever they want to eat. And that's not at all what Christ is having Paul write here. He's saying their God is their stomach, and that these people that come from a Jewish background are saying, we keep all the dietary laws. What we put in us is what we think makes us righteous. Whereas Christ said, it's not what you put in, it's what comes out that you're judged on. So they're saying, we think that by the way we eat, we're better than everybody else. That other side has it wrong. And he says their glory is their shame. In other words, he's saying they're going around bragging about the fact that they are circumcised, which is shameful. Why are you talking about that subject matter all the time? That is a private area, and it's actually shameful. One, because of that, but two, do you see how ridiculous it is? That's what you're bragging about? That is shameful. You should be embarrassed at the disadvantage you've created for yourself, putting your trust into that. And then he says, finally, they are focused on earthly things. So because they have a worldview that is based on the culture or based on earthly matters that they are pursuing, their focus is entirely on what is physically around them here on earth. So, am I pushing the fact that I would say that we should just kind of have our head up in the clouds and just completely forget what's going around us versus being only concerned about what's happening here in society today. I'm not saying that. Paul's not saying that. It is so much easier to just take one extreme or the other and run with it. Paul is saying there is a balance here where we are called to have a Christian worldview of how we are to serve God right now, right here, in this world, but we're not staring at the world trying to earn its favor. We are looking at the resurrection that's coming when Christ returns and knowing everything that we're working out right now, that is our end goal. That is what we are shooting for because things are never going to be perfect here. Things are probably not going to be good very often either. So we don't focus on those worldly things. We focus on Christ. So, looking at that, Paul is going to go on and he's going to answer the question of, okay, if we are rejecting self-righteousness of doing the right things, of the Jewish people keeping kosher laws or circumcision laws, or we're going to church and we're getting baptized and we take communion and we think all those actions are going to help us out, if we reject those things, if we reject focusing on earthly things as our goal, how are we supposed to live? What is the answer to this? Paul says in verse 20, the reason and the answer is our citizenship is in heaven. And so if we feel at home here in this world, that's a warning sign that we are missing the point. If we can comfortably call ourselves by a label the world has created, if we comfortably align ourselves with the Republican Party or with the Democratic Party or with the People Who Have No Chance Party, if we're completely comfortable with what these people are saying and we are completely comfortable on all of the positions, that is a big warning sign that as Christians, something is out of line in our life. Now, I'm not saying it's wrong for you to vote one way, straight down the card, right? What I am saying is, if there are no things that make you upset coming out of either side of the equation, then you're missing the point that your citizenship is in heaven, because imperfect people running something are never going to be correct. And they're looking at earthly goals, which is what these perfectionist Jewish groups were doing. Instead, we have to look forward to Christ's return and our eternal state of heaven. So, we are primarily citizens of heaven. That's my home. Now, I have a very nice temporary residence right now, and I am an American second, and I should be a good citizen because we ought to glorify Christ with all things, but that is secondary. It's not our main goal. What I want us to understand here is that the worldview of following Christ is political. That the very thing of being a Christian is political. It is a worldview system that should affect every single area of our lives. It's not just what we hope to get to heaven with. Don Carson wrote, he said, the New Testament does not offer a lot of encouragement for people who want just enough Christianity to be saved. So if you think that, you know, you said a prayer, you filled out a card, you took the communion or gave to the church or whatever, and it's just enough to make sure you get to heaven, you're missing the point because it's a life change. So the classical definition of what politics is, not what we've seen on TV for the past month, but what politics really is. What does it really mean? It is an encompassing manner of communal life that grapples with the questions. The classical art of politics is always asked, how do we live together? How do we deal with our enemies and violence? How do we arrange our marriages and our family and our social structures? How do we put authority in place? How do we find employment? How do we order these things? How do we order our passions? Where is human history headed? What does it even mean to be human? What does it look like to live in a rightly ordered human community? These are all questions that politics has been asking since day one, and every single one of those answers are found in Scripture. Now, does he perfectly lay out here for us verbatim how we ought to run an election? No, because this is written to the original audience, but for the benefit of every generation and every nation. But those principles underlying, and Paul is saying, if you're a grown-up Christian, you're a mature Christian, then you ought to agree with other Christians on what this is saying and then work together on how we practically play that out, right? So we are following this and looking for a worldview, a philosophy, a politic that is transcending our immediate context and our immediate culture. He says, our citizenship is in heaven and we eagerly wait for the Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will transform the body of our humble condition into the likeness of his glorious body by the power that enables him to subject everything to himself. And then chapter 4, verse 1 continues the thought and says, so then, my dearly loved and longed for brothers and sisters, my joy and crown, in this manner, stand firm in the Lord Jesus. So he's saying, this must shape everything that we do, especially these day-to-day decisions we make that are our politic of how we live our lives and our worldview, and it must transcend the culture and the context that we are in. So I had the advantage, there was a digital conference this week, and Matt Chandler was the opening preacher, and he was sharing encouragement for pastors and elders. And I loved his example that, we stay so focused on our immediate context, forgetting what lies ahead in the future, and that these principles are eternal regardless of what system of government we have in charge of us. And he told this story that I told the person with me I was stealing for this week, where he went to Italy for a conference to lead a few years ago, and he paid $20 to tour the Colosseum. And he walked around this ancient building where they used to imprison Christians. They used to feed our brothers and sisters to lions for entertainment and persecute the church. And the goal of the government was to squash Christianity and eradicate it from all history. And now, 2,000 years later, he's only paying $20 to walk over their bones and their remains. This mighty government for 1,500 years, their purpose at this time was to kill off any mention of Christ. And now it's falling apart, and he only had to pay $20 to see it. And so we live in a culture where, again, we're thankful for, but our 300-year history is really about the same time period of the book of Judges. How fast do we read through the book of Judges and move on? If there was the history book here, that's the same section our history as a people in America would take up. And we have to remember that while we have a great place where we can freely share the gospel, and we're thankful for that, in 1,000 years, someone's going to pay $20 to tour the White House and barely remember that some guys were in charge there. Can anybody name for me 5 Roman emperors? And they ran it for 1,500 years. They're not going to remember us. We are not more special than Rome or Persia or China or any of these other places. It is a temporary tool that God has given us, which we will look at later weeks. And we have to transcend above this idea that we are something special and that by pushing our version of politics, we're God's gift to the world. We are a temporary structure, like renting a home. You take good care of the house, you clean it, you cut the grass, but if you're temporarily at a house, are you going to cash out for some major repairs, tear up the foundation and pay $30,000 to get it fixed? No, you understand it's temporary and it's a good place to house your family and you take care of it, but you have your eyes focused on a later goal and prize. And so quickly here, I know we are really pushing time, but what I want us to understand is when I say that our citizenship transcends our immediate context and culture and time, what does that mean? And so what that means is 3 things here. Number one, when I say that it transcends those things, what that means is that Christianity, our purpose, is not confined to or held back by, insert the blank. So when I say that the kingdom of heaven, which is our citizenship, when I say it transcends these worldly things, what I mean is, number one, that our kingdom that we are citizens of is not of this world. It's in it. It's here, and Christ is coming in fulfillment, but it is not of this world. Quickly in John 18, when Pilate is questioning Jesus before the execution, he says, hey, man, are you the king? They're claiming you're the king. And Jesus says, are you asking me that, or did those guys say that? Who's asking me this? And Pilate says, well, I'm not a Jew. It's your own people that are questioning you, and they said you're claiming to be a king. So what have you done? Are you the king? And Jesus says in verse 36 of John 18, he says, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. And Pilate says, I just love the ignorance of missing, and we probably would have made the same mistake. And he's like, so, you know, it's like watching a Supreme Court hearing, like they just ask the same question on both sides. But he's like, so you are a king then? Like, I didn't ask about that. Are you a king? And he says, you say I'm a king. I was born for this and have come into the world for this, to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice. The truth is scripture. It is the message of Christ. And then Pilate, showing that people have not changed in the past 2,000 years, says, what is truth? So the questioning of what is true or what is real hasn't changed. We are looking for ways to squirm out of responsibility since day one. And so what I want us to see with that, instead of diving into it, is it's not of this world. We are in it. We ought to, as Romans 1 and chapter 12, verses 1 through 2 says, we ought to have our minds transformed by the word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to grow and mature us. So we are here, we are doing God's work, but this is not the kingdom. It is not American imperialism or British imperialism or Russian imperialism. It is in the world, but it's not created of the world. It transcends any culture or time or place or people. The second way that we have to realize that we are primarily citizens of heaven is that the kingdom does not have any borders. So we as people have always loved, and I'm not saying this is wrong, it's good for structure, but we've drawn these arbitrary lines on maps and said, okay, I'm an American and you are French, and so I don't like you now because I don't like the French, right? We draw these arbitrary borders and think that they make some kind of difference in who a person is. And what I want us to see with that is in Galatians 3, 27 and 28 is, for those of you who are baptized in Christ have been clothed with Christ. There is no Jew, there's no Greek, there's no slave or there's no free, there is not male or female, since you are all one in Christ Jesus. So yes, people are Jewish or Greek by birth. People might be can in the bonds of slavery, or they might be free from slavery. He's not arguing for some kind of transgender thing. There are male and female, but he's saying none of those restrictions matter anymore because our kingdom does not have any borders in this earth or beyond. And so he's saying that when we identify as people who are trusting in Christ and looking forward to his return in the fulfillment of the full kingdom of heaven, that means that we are no longer white or black. We're no longer American or Mexican. We are no longer Republican or Democrat. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. An abbreviated version of this story, some of you may have heard, during World War I in 1914, there was this Christmas Eve truce. So I see some of you shaking your heads. What happened was the different sides that were fighting, you had French, German, and British soldiers. And I mean, that war is so gross, and the trench warfare and all these things. And the week before Christmas, they all agreed to stop shooting each other and on Christmas Eve have a Christmas party with one another. And people tell that story and they're like, isn't the bond of humanity? Oh, human beings, we're so great and look how we love each other. Now, all of those nations were Christian nations at the time. And the people back then probably would have at least checked off Christian on their census. And I have to believe that there are genuine Christ followers on all sides. And so when I see that, I don't see a compliment to human beings. I see the horror of the fact that the next day, brothers and sisters in Christ started shooting each other. Now, I'm not anti-war. I have concealed carry. I would drop somebody before they hurt my kids. But what I am saying is, we have to stop hating people just because of whatever group we want to pigeon them into. The other thing with that is, as we look at that, when we see that, I wanted to point out here something that really bothered me recently. I genuinely am a John MacArthur fan. Most of the time, some of the things, yeah. So, having said that, I'm now going to say how angry he made me. When he got on the news and told people, he's told President Trump that any real Christian will vote for Donald Trump. I guarantee if he had said any real Christian gets baptized by immersion, any real Christian doesn't cuss, any real Christian does X, Y, Z, people would be up in arms because that's adding an extra qualification to salvation. Now, he could have said, in my opinion, a mature Christian would most likely make the decision to vote for Trump. Or he could have said, in my opinion, I think a mature Christian would choose to vote for Biden. What he said was, hey, President, if anybody is really a Christian, they're going to do this. So if they don't, they're not a Christian. And that's creating arbitrary boundaries between us in the church. And it is what Paul would call a pile of... So, we're not drawing restrictions here. I have people that I love dearly who will flat out look you in the face and say that if you vote Democrat, you're not really saved. And I don't have people that say the same thing the other way, but I guarantee they're out there, right? We are not putting these arbitrary boundaries of these groups above our citizenship in heaven. We can talk as mature Christians about it, and we can share our issue, and we're going to look at that next week of how we look at these issues, but stop drawing boundaries and stop making an enemy out of the people that you don't agree with. And then finally here, the third thing, the way that we transcend this world and its arbitrary borders and we transcend being of the world is that the kingdom points to our king. If we are citizens of a kingdom, that means we have a king. 1 Peter 2:9 quotes back in the Torah, which you should recognize from Leviticus, and he tells us today, we are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his possession, so that we may proclaim the praises of the one who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And Matthew 5 is a verse that people are probably familiar with, where he says, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket, but they put it up on the lampstand, and it gives light for the entire house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so they may see your good works and give glory to the Father in heaven. And so the kingdom points to the king, and if Christ is our king, that means our existence, our politics, serves to point to Christ. That is the goal, is to point to Christ, that we have to be a light. And so when we are bickering and when we are sharing offensive things online, I have seen members of this church share pretty, if not racist, borderline racist things and hateful things. And that's not all of you, but you know, I've seen these things happening here in a Christian community. Is that reflecting the light of Christ to anybody when we draw those? Again, vote for whichever side you are convicted of, and it is good to be responsible and share your opinions, but stop being a jerk about it. Are you sharing Christ with others through the way that you demonstrate your politic? Is that what you're doing? Because the people that say we have hope, and again, this isn't anti-tirade, but I want us to remember that we have people who are not looking forward to the resurrection who are running this place. So if we're called to be a light, here is what the world says about our current position. Ronald Reagan, in his address throughout his thing, he kept referring to this city on a hill. We ought to be this shining light. In his farewell address, he clarified what he meant. He meant that the American system of democracy should be a light to all of the world. So he has taken scripture and he has twisted it and taken Christ out. That's idolatry. As well, Woodrow Wilson after World War I said, hey, this, I'm paraphrasing here, but in his address there, he said, hey, this was a really good thing because now, end quote, he says that all the world now knows that America is the savior of the world. We had last year in the inaugural address, again, not dogging him over his politics, but our president said, we must keep America first in our hearts. And we must always keep faith in American destiny, that one nation under God must be the hope and the promise and the light and glory among all the nations of the world. Friends, that is unbiblical and that is idolatry. And we need to pray for his heart He's our president now, and he may be for the next 4 years. And I'm not, I mean, look, we've got his opponent who is claiming to be Catholic and not willing to share the gospel with anybody. So I'm dogging both of them and saying one of them is going to be God's appointed leader here that we are going to pray for, but both of them need serious prayer because this is what the White House says is our hope. And it is not. It's good. It's a great tool God has given us. But if we keep our country first in our hearts, that's idolatry. So, in closing, when I say that we have to transcend our culture, our time, our context, that means that we are not called to preach politics in this nasty season that is what's become normal. Our purpose is to share the hope of Christ with the world. If we as a church here and universally would push the message of the gospel as much as we like to push our opinion on which of two people are going to enter the White House, I think we'd make a much bigger difference in the world while also praying for them. And so our message that we are supposed to preach is that what is the point of humanity? What is the goal of history? Is it just one stupid thing after the other? No, it is the fact that we are incapable of saving ourselves for eternity. We're pretty close to incapable of governing ourselves here on this earth as fallible human beings. We recognize that we need someone to save us as our king, and that is Christ, who came fully God and fully man and lived a perfect sinless life, then died on the cross to pay the penalty of sin, then resurrected physically from the grave and ascended into heaven and is seated on his throne, taking care of us, mediating for us, controlling us, and he's returning. And that is what we are looking forward to. So if you feel like you can't share the gospel, there it is. We need him. He didn't sin. He died for us. He rose again. He's on the throne, and he's coming back. That is our worldview. So if you guys will pray with me here and continue to digest this, and next week, then we will look and see what Scripture says is the Christian position on how we think through these things. And we had the band come forward here for closing. If you need prayer, I'll be up here after the service. If you have never surrendered your life to Christ and this idea of why you need him and being saved just by trusting in him, if that's new to you, I'd love to talk to you after the service, or you can fill out a connection card and drop it in. If you need prayer for anything, we could do that as well. And I'll pray with you here. Father God, thank you that we have hope, that we are not just kind of blindly groping around in the darkness trying to figure out things, or that our hope would possibly rely on what takes place in 3 weeks, that we see that the upcoming election, while in immediate context is important, Lord, that we know that we know how the story ends. We know that you will hold fast to your people and that you're coming back for us, that you're transforming this world and that we are citizens of your kingdom. So I just ask the Holy Spirit, you would help each of us to grow, to put away our self-righteousness of thinking we're always right, and to grow in what you've given us in Scripture. And as we pray this week, I pray that you would move our hearts to pray for President Trump and the presidential nominee Biden, that you would move us to care deeply about both of those persons, that they would both come and have faith in you and be saved, and that you would be glorified in that. I pray that you would move our hearts to make a difference in our immediate context and help us to keep our eyes focused on your return, on your grace, and on your mercy and your love. We give these things to you. In Jesus' name, amen.